David, it's an absolute pleasure to have you here with us. What does it mean for you to be part of this beautiful celebration of the action genre?
I have great affinity with people who create the things that we're looking at, because a lot of the time you never know who they are. You don't even really know the names necessarily. But when you realize that, you know, possibly on an action movie, probably 70, 80% of what you're looking at is someone whose name you don't know, but are taking all the risks, designing all the gags. And I mean, I've done a lot. I mean, for music, action is really difficult because it's usually fast and there's usually a lot of notes, which means a lot of work. So you know, it's quite hard trying to keep up with the energy of the people in it. So to have someone say thank you to those people, I'm very happy to be a part of that system, because we rely on them, you know, rely on them to be brilliant.
I'm curious if you can distill the essence of what good action music is and how it works.
Well, I don't think it's weight, and I don't think it's volume. I suppose that leaves mass, doesn't it? maybe the scientific thing's not a good... The thing that I always feel about action music is that there is an energy that you have to match. That doesn't necessarily mean it has to be loud. It doesn't necessarily mean it has to be, you know, mega, like, percussive. It just needs to have an energy in it. And sometimes, if you listen to John Williams' action writing in some of the Star Wars movies, it's very balletic. There are things that you feel are exciting, and when you listen to the music by itself, it's actually quite light on its feet. Contemporary action films are more like kind of pounding things and then adding and adding and adding and adding. But I'm a big fan of the, you know, waiting for those moments to happen, and then in between trying to write in and around action. It's very much a skill of itself, and I think the only way you can really learn it is by doing it. But I think if you, with action, you have to find out where you can be heard and know that if someone's flying a helicopter or shooting a machine gun, there's no point writing anything, really.
Can you talk a little bit about what is unique about Bond music and how proud you feel to have been such a big part of crafting and continuing that legacy?
I think I've said it before that, you know, the shadow of John Barry looms over every composer who sits in that chair, because he quite simply created the sound of James Bond in music. I think the music that he wrote, the arrangements, the choice of instrumentation, the tone of it, the colour of it, if you shut your eyes, you're still in the movie. That's what he did so brilliantly. And that's the thing that made me want to do it. I saw You Only Live Twice when I was very young, and within 5 minutes of that film opening, you've got the James Bond theme, you've got the capsule in space, and you've got that incredible song, You Only Live Twice. All of these things, for a kid from Luton who's eight, seemed incredibly exotic and exciting. And it was about the sound of it. So for me, it's about realizing what the DNA of that is, and hopefully keeping true to that whilst moving it a bit forward. I always thought it's a bit like carrying an Olympic torch. You know, the job is to keep it alight, because you're going to hand it on to someone at some point, but keep the thing alight.
We're at yet another point of transition for the character and the franchise. As someone who's been so deeply involved with it, do you have ambitions or hopes for what we're going to see from our next Bond and the franchise as a whole?
Well, I've always said that you could have 1,000 people who claim to be the biggest Bond fans in the world in the same room, and 500 of them will say it should be this way, and 500 of them should be the opposite way. And they'll all be right in their own way, and they'll all be wrong in their own way. I think everyone's got an idea about what they'd like. But what I've always loved about a Bond movie is that from the opening moments, the potential for that film to be the best one you've ever seen is always there. And that's always really exciting. And the second most exciting part is right at the end. As long as it says James Bond will return, even if you've loved it, or even if you haven't loved it as much as your favorite, you still think the next one. And it's been all my life, you know. So that moment is still incredibly important. So you can imagine how relieved I was at the end of No Time to Die to see that come up at the end.
I think we all were.